talk about today are these six key moves. And you can see them mapped out here just geographically to give you a sense. They more or less fall two in the south reach, two in the middle reach, and two in the north reach. And they're represented in front of you. And each of these moves, of course, has many, many other moves kind of within it. But in order to sort of get our heads around it, we're dividing it that way. So I'm going to start with the ones that are in the south reach. And as you probably know, the south reach is by far the most challenging location, because it's where all the different challenges come together in a very constrained space, where the erosion is, where most of the infrastructure is, and so forth. So key move number one, as you probably turn it by now from the boards and the handout, is rerouting the Great Highway behind the zoo via Sloat and Skyline. And this is, I think, a very, very important organizing idea for how we start to address what's going on in the South Reach. Basically, what that then allows is closing the southern stretch of the Great Highway from Sloat to Skyline, the coast road there. The corrosive pressure there is likely to get worse and worse over time, and our attempts to protect that are just going to continue to be more and more difficult. And so the idea is we can make this work by routing that traffic around the back of the zoo and pick up a great deal of flexibility. So that is going to require a number of sub-moves, which you see in front of you, reconfiguring the intersections at Sloat and Great Highway and at Sloat and Skyline. And our traffic engineers have told us that this is likely to work very well, that it's not going to pose tremendous traffic impacts. Some of you may remember that a portion of the road was closed after the 2010 storms for the better part of the year, and there were some traffic impacts there. But it's important to understand that that was done without any of the traffic improvements that would have made that work from a circulation standpoint. So we're talking about doing something much different, very methodical, and very careful, and carefully studied. We would be maintaining one lane out southbound from the Oceanside Treatment Plant for trucks leaving the plant. That was something that was important to the PUC to keep that operating. But other than that, the Great Highway in that stretch would be closed. Sloat Boulevard would be reconfigured with parking moved to the south edge of the road, so you no longer have families with children arriving in that diagonal parking in the median and running across three lanes of traffic, as well as providing a bikeway, permeable pavements, and coastal access amenities. So some of that parking and restrooms that might be eliminated on the coast would be backed into the Sloat corridor and still provide that that gateway at the foot of Sloat Boulevard.
Ben, would you trace with your finger the reconfiguration of the Sloat Great Highway, a car going north, a car going south?
Absolutely, yeah, that's a great way of doing it. So northbound, you'd be coming up Skyline, and where today you would make a left onto the Great Highway and go this way. Under this proposal, you would follow Skyline all the way here to Sloat, make a left at Sloat through a reconfigured intersection there, along a reconfigured Sloat Boulevard to the Great Highway, and then you would make a right there. And then southbound, obviously, the reverse. A couple of other features that make this work, I think, very, very well, is the El Terra valve then having the opportunity to cross Sloat and stop at the gateway to the zoo. So that would mean that these intersections would also need to be reconfigured and signalized. But what that would do is, instead of the El Terra valve terminating in the middle of a neighborhood in kind of a random location, one additional short block and you would be able to drop people off from transit at the zoo with a contiguous pedestrian and bike-friendly access to the coast, where we would introduce a new coastal trail and also to the zoo. So again, eliminating a lot of pedestrian hazards, much more family-friendly, much more transit-friendly. And of course, the big win from a kind of human recreational and access to nature standpoint is that the coast no longer has a highway on it. You have the opportunity to create a beautiful coastal trail in front of the zoo and connecting to Fort Funston, which is a key open space connection that has not been made to date. So looking at one of several possible arrangements of Sloat Boulevard, that Sloat Boulevard today with the angled parking in the middle, a massively over-constructed road for the relative to the amount of traffic it carries today and even that it would carry under this new scheme. So narrowing that road In this version showing two lanes, or rather three lanes, one lane in each direction plus a center turning lane. You could also do a four lane scheme depending on what you're doing to other roadways. And then using the southern edge of that along the edge of the zoo right here for parking pockets, for a bikeway that connects into that coastal trail, and for again that transit terminus there. So the benefits of this approach, obviously the spectacular new coastal trail is a very important aspect of this. It enables a very different approach to coastal management. When we get rid of the road, we no longer are trying to protect the road and the bluff that the road sits on. So it allows a lot of coastal retreat. Instead of trying to hold the line right where it is today, we can incrementally back away and focus on protecting only those things that we really need to protect and that really are providing important services. So again, allowing a more flexible approach to the infrastructure. And then major improvements to Slow Boulevard, providing not only a better human environment, a better transit environment, but also a better natural environment by integrating stormwater management into that, into the Slow Boulevard reconfiguration, building a green streets concept that is very much in line with the city's thinking from the Better Streets Plan and other initiatives. Now, constraints, obviously there are likely to be some traffic implications and complications of this, but we have been told by the traffic engineers that actually that this works very well. And if you also consider that the current Great Highway situation does not work very well because it's frequently closed by blowing sands, by special events, by the erosion that took place that had it closed in part for the better part of the year. There are a lot of problems with the current configuration, this can work very well in terms of circulation. It requires reconfiguring zoo access. That's an important one. The zoo is a very important player and they're very involved in this process. They currently have egress from their parking lot onto the Great Highway. They would need to have access via Armory Road, which is actually the last thing on your list here. Reopen Armory Road, which runs behind to the southern edge of the zoo. And right now is a service road for them. That would need to be circulation roads so that people could get out of their parking lot without depending on the Great Highway running right along the coastline there.
Ben, yes. You have also parking on the Oceanside Treatment Plant.
Yes, so along Armory Road there, the southern part of the zoo, and I think I can back up to the plan view. There are so many pieces to these, of course, it's hard to convey them all, but so this is Armory Road here. Right now, the zoo parking exits onto the Great Highway. And if we were to close the Great Highway, the exit from the parking would need to go onto Armory Road. So that would need to be opened up. There's the opportunity to provide additional zoo parking in this area, as well as on the roof of the treatment plant, which was originally designed to actually be expansion space for the zoo to hold large animal paddocks. So thinking about the zoo over the long haul, especially as erosion coastal pressures set in, there's a real opportunity for the zoo to start thinking about making more use of this area. We're also talking about introducing a wetland feature in part of the zoo parking lot. Most of that would be unaffected, but that starts to make us think about how the zoo can kind of step out of its most low-lying vulnerable area.
Along the same lines there, so is that auxiliary parking 1.7, is that going to be used for recreational park or?
That's a good question, and I think it's actually probably important that some of this be coastal access parking. This is still at a very conceptual level, but I think that's a good point because especially in this scheme, we're actually losing the existing parking lot, providing coastal parking along that slope corridor, so there is definitely good access there. But then also I think part of that would be needing to provide some additional coastal access further south. I think you next.
Any idea that the Army Reserve operation is going to move?
The what, sorry? Oh, the Army Reserve, yeah. I have heard, I don't have like a really good answer, but I have heard that their lease is going to be expiring in a decade or two. And I think it's important to think about, especially on that sort of 2100, 2200 time horizon, when this may be a very difficult situation to maintain, that there is a reserve armory up here on some very high ground that's not necessarily an ideal location, and that we should be thinking about that as part of the mix. I think Nancy.
Could you point out where the slope restroom would be relocated to?
Yeah, so it would be in the slope corridor
adjacent to the pump station or thereabouts.
How far is the Elton Valley?
Currently?
The coast. I see where it is, but it's not scaled, so just kind of approximately?
Approximately one block.
So people could easily walk there, so maybe you don't need as much parking?
Yeah, I mean, I think, it's a question of sort of the number of spaces. The lot that's there right now is very heavily subscribed. I think we could hope that we would get, if this were a really terrific arrival experience, we might be getting more arrivals at the zoo by transit. I don't think, given the location, it's going to be an easy thing to be predominantly or exclusively transit access. But I think we can also think about spreading things out and having less of a landscape that's less dominated by parking. You mean down here?
Yeah.
There's an opportunity there as well. No, I think we should move on.
The zoo has had some interest in maybe expanding where you want to have parking, and then also the PUC has been looking at in that area for possibly a recycled water plant.
Yeah, so there are a lot of pieces of this puzzle that need to be worked out with the zoo, with the PUC, with the National Park Service. But this is kind of something that we think solves for a lot of the pieces and then needs to be sort of carried forward. But all those entities have seen this and been in principle interested in continuing the discussion. I want to move on to what this major move then makes possible. Just to close out these sort of the summary bit of this. So outstanding questions. First of all, the constraints we talked about, traffic impacts, which would likely be minor, reconfiguring the zoo access, which is very important, the cost of roadway and intersection improvements, which is likely to be not trivial. Outstanding questions is the exact nature of those traffic impacts, the exact configuration of Slope Boulevard. As we've said, there are various different alternatives that are possible depending on what we do elsewhere. And then finally, how all this would be funded, which is obviously a major challenge for any proposal going forward. So key move number two is intimately related with this. Key move number one makes key move number two possible. And this is, in many ways, the toughest nut to crack, is how we manage the relationship between coastal access, environmental restoration, and protecting coastal infrastructure. And so what we are discussing here is introducing a multi-purpose coastal protection, environmental restoration, and access system south of Slope. And I'm going to walk through some of the ingredients of that. First of all, with the road absent in the area immediately in front of the zoo, so we're really talking about this area right here, we then get the opportunity to withdraw from the existing bluff edge, the existing revetments, and so forth, and incrementally demolish the roadway, parking, and the restroom at Slope, and really pursue a managed retreat strategy to a great extent immediately adjacent to the zoo at the coast. We would propose reinforcing the Lake Merced tunnel in place with a low-profile structure. One of our insights here, and we'll see this in the sections when we look at it, is that when you remove the roadway is way up in vertical space. And a lot of the challenge of protecting the coast now has been with protecting that bluff, most of which is not actually bluff, it's actually construction fill that was put in there to shore up the road when the infrastructure was built. When we're not trying to defend that, the pipe itself is actually quite low in space. And there are a lot of engineering questions about what exactly is possible, but what we're pushing is to try to defend the pipe very, very low in space and allow a beach profile to develop over it. So I want to talk about some of the sort of details of that. Sand nourishment via the Army Corps of Engineering, dredging that sand and bringing it to the beach is fundamental to the approach that we're talking about. On top of the low-profile structure that would protect the Lake Merced tunnel would also be what's called a cobble berm, which is a different type of coastal protection that hasn't been tried here before. What that is instead of big boulders that are intended to never move, and that's what they do, we would use a revetment made of sort of baseball-size or softball-size stones. And what that does is excellent at diffusing wave energy but it also can move and can take shape according to the natural process. So we're talking about layering soft structures that are very resilient over hard structures, and then also then placing a great deal of sand over top of that. And I want to show you some sections of what that looks like. So here's a Lake Merced tunnel. Here is the existing bluff top where the Great Highway sits today. Here is the Lake Merced tunnel. As you can see, the level of the Lake Merced tunnel is quite low. And the principle here and the real question mark going forward in terms of what is feasible engineering-wise is to protect this with a very low profile structure. The way the tunnel is designed is that it was bored through relatively hard material. It wasn't laid in a trench and then covered over. So it's engineered with the expectation that it's going to have a bunch of stuff around it holding it in. But we are very interested in exploring the idea of protecting that structure through structurally modifying, taking a different approach. So instead of having a whole lot of material around it, we put a very strong structure very low to the ground immediately around it. And then we use the secondary protection in the form of the cobble berm there, and again a second cobble berm in front of the next set of pipes, which is the force mains that connect the pump station to the treatment plant, and then covering that entire thing with sand, which actually can work its way down into a cobble berm and form a kind of aggregate. So you get quite a resilient system, but with the insurance policy of a very hard structure underneath it. This allows us to not only protect the infrastructure in place, which is a major major piece of infrastructure that we all depend on and quite expensive to relocate, but it then allows us to do a surface restoration that allows us to have a beach. It allows us to have an aesthetically pleasing environment that allows good access, and we're envisioning a coastal trail here. By defending this low to the ground, we're not saying we're going to hold the ocean at bay. Instead, we're saying we're going to sort of have some protection of this thing, but the most severe storm events would actually overtop this. And we use this horizontal space, this retreat zone that we created, to diffuse wave energy over the course of it. So we're spreading things out instead of trying to do it all in a single line.
Has there been a detailed analysis of the sewer pipe vulnerability at this point?
There are numerous different documents out there analyzing it. A lot of those live with the PUC and the DPW, and we are in close consultation with their engineers about that. So it's certainly very vulnerable right now, especially in a few short reaches. There are places where it's already quite a hazard. On the other hand, the California Coastal Commission ruled in July against the city's desire to continue adding additional revetment. So the city's kind of between a rock and a hard place right now, where on the one hand, there's a very real hazard, and the downside of hazard to this pipe is that it's full of sewage. So a sewer spill in this environment would be catastrophic from an environmental standpoint. So the city can't let that happen. On the other hand, there's a great deal of hue and cry about the approach to date, both from advocates and from the Coastal Commission, saying we don't want any more of these revetments and hard structures. How are you going to handle this? So this is an attempt to solve for as many of those pieces as possible.
So part of this plan must then be to repair or replace that actual dangerous pipe?
Well, the piping itself is fine right now.
Okay, that's not the danger.
Yeah, exactly. The question is, what happens when there's a series of major storms and suddenly you get to a point where there's not enough material between the water and the pipe? The pipe wants to float. That's one of the problems with it. Mostly it's empty. Most of the time it's empty. So if it's underwater or in a major storm surge comes, it wants to float. It can be pushed in and out. It can be moved by earthquakes. There's a lot of things that have to happen to make sure that that pipe is safe. So that's a critical component of this. But we are advocating for an approach that protects it very, very low down, and instead of holding the line here, we would allow the most severe storms to actually run up and over this thing and diffuse their wave energy through this basin that's immediately behind it.
Sorry. Does that mean that after storm events, you have to do maintenance of that cobble berm?
Yeah, the cobble berm tends to be very resilient. It tends to stay in place and change shape, although, you know, portions of it can definitely be pushed around. The other thing that you would, that this kind of turns on doing on a regular basis is that direct placement of sand. So what, in a very severe storm, you might have a lot of sand stripped away from your system, but you'd still have something that was reasonably attractive that is passable by a person, unlike a revetna where you're sort of taking your life into your hands and kick your way across it. And we have some images of cobble burns. I'm not sure I have any in this. This is another good kind of illustration of the approach that we're talking about. Yeah?
Would it be helpful to describe kind of the worst case condition that we would imagine, which is that inverted L-shaped wall would be exposed and, you know, for some time, let's say, after a storm. In which case, if that wall was exposed, it would tend to look like the Terrebell seawall. If you go to Terrebell Street and walk over the dunes, you can see the top of a concrete wall with a concrete lid on it. It's been there since about the 40s.
Is that what that is?
Yeah, and it's a very similar structure to that, a vertical wall with a cap. And it would end up being about the same elevation, maybe a little bit lower. So at worst case, that would be the...
So unobtrusive relative to a big revetment or a big seawall that's intended to kind of hold those cliffs up in their entirety. The other thing that's important to understand, so that's kind of the basic principle for the area immediately south of Slope adjacent to the zoo. But of course, it's not one size fits all, right? The conditions change as you move south. You have the actual bluff no longer filled, but the real thing rising up here. And you have another erosion hotspot down adjacent to the treatment plant. So there's several other sections that show how this system would take shape. So as you move south, you saw the one we were just looking at. This is the interim condition where this space is shorter. You don't have nearly as much of a basin behind, but the same approach to the pipe applies. And then moving further south, where you're much higher up and there's a much more significant bluff. This is showing the one lane out from the treatment plant up there, where you'd also have a bluff top multi-use trail. And then you would have some kind of a terraced system where the Lake Merced Tunnel would still exist in a low profile underneath. And then you could have a vegetative seawall that had kind of landscape features and access in a way to sort of promenade along there. And another piece that's very important to consider in this is we would want to leave natural material in the bluff face for the bank swallow habitat. So the way we've been thinking about this is at least until 2050, it's likely that we would be able to have a natural eroding bluff face and the bank swallow colony continue to nest in here. After 2050, it's not unlikely that you would need to do some kind of a vertical seawall there. But the idea is to preserve that for as long as possible while integrating the needs of the plant, the needs of recreational access, and also an aesthetic and solid treatment of the tunnel. Just to give you a sense of the contrast between existing conditions and what we're proposing, this is just a sort of conceptual diagram of what's there now. So the exposed fill you see immediately south of Slope, that's that rubble material that was underlying the road. It's now been exposed by erosion. And then further south, the revetments. And then you see the current ocean level. And we'll go back and forth a few times. So existing, and then with the 2050, ocean level. So you see the beach is definitely continuing to get narrower. You have this pipe structure covered with cobble and covered with sand and the basin behind it that you'd actually allow some coastal overwash into. And then as you move further south, it gets to be more of a bluff-like condition. And here are some images of actual cobble berms that have been done. This one in Anchorage, Alaska, that's then covered with sand, so it really just reads as a speed bump in the beach. And then when it's more exposed, it's actually under construction in Ventura County, something that Bob has worked on. That would then be covered up with sand. But you can imagine sort of the worst case scenario, you would have exposed cobble and you might actually see the underlying pipe protection structure as a terrible type seawall.
Yeah, Bill. Well, do you folks plan on knowing for sure whether this is feasible or not, whether that trichlor box can actually
So we're in ongoing conversation with the PUC, and I should say that they're very receptive to thinking about these ideas. They need to develop both a kind of immediate approach to the coming couple of seasons because they're facing some very significant hazards, and also more like sort of 10-year approach. This is more sort of in the 20 to 50-year horizon, so there's some time to kind of figure out exactly what's feasible, what works. We're talking to their engineers about the needs of the pipe and about the approach to coastal erosion, and they're working on an approach that isn't predicated on protecting the road and bluffs, so there's been a real shift in thinking, and that would definitely take more account of the other objectives than simply protecting the infrastructure. So we're not doing that directly as the master plan process, but we're in close communication with the PUC. So I think you're likely to see some shifts in terms of the approach in the near term, and done in a way that doesn't preclude an approach like this for the long term, which is a key idea that's being put forward by the commission, really asking the city to make sure that that they don't preclude the long-term approach.
Okay, this ocean level 2050 that's here, is this based on expected erosion of the beach or expected sea level rise connected with global warming or
both?
Some combination?
So those two things are in a kind of dynamic interplay. The sea level rise, the frequency and severity of storms, the placement and presence of sand, and how those things all interact together, that's the stuff that Bob understands that no one else understands.
So it's not that complicated. In a nutshell, what we did was we projected historic erosion rates going forward based on the amount of sand supply to the area. And then we took the state's interim guidance for sea level rise and essentially took the beach profile and what we call transgressed it up and in according to a geomorphic approach. In other words, as the sea level rises, the waves would act higher up on the profile and they'd build the beach back and up a little bit. And so, and then we, looking at the beach nourishment, we took a certain amount of sand every so often, placed it on the beach, and converted that back to a beach width. So we essentially modeled the profile over the time frame, right? These, you know, different pieces. And so what we're seeing here is an estimate of what would happen with the sea level rise scenario and the management interventions.
Yeah, the one thing we can be totally confident of with both sea level rise and the sort of precise approach that we propose is that we'll be wrong.
Yeah.
Right? We're trying to work with the best available information, the assumptions that the state technical agencies are working with.
One thing that I think is really important to emphasize here is part of what we were trying to do is rather than defend a little beach to really make sure that the beach is getting bigger and more accessible in this scheme. And so even though you see that the beach, that the sea level is rising, you still have a wider beach in most of this section in 50 years than you do today. And so that was a really important thing for us to think about, to make it much more accessible and wider and
yeah, and to use that width kind of conceptually as how we diffuse wave energy. So the big threat here is the force of the waves that are constantly coming, and instead of trying to hold it in one place, stretching that out over the system so you have those multiple cobble berms that's breaking up that wave energy without doing what a seawall does, because it's fixed, it reflects that wave energy back out and you end up with a scouring effect. Okay, so that's, I should